Yeah, okay, ma'am. So, hi everyone, good evening, and I welcome you all to the webinar on food adulteration, consumer awareness, and mitigation strategies. We have a very valuable keynote speaker who has joined us in today's session. I would like to welcome Dr. P. Savita. Good evening, ma'am, and thank you very much for joining us today.
Good evening.
Yeah, before we proceed, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker. So Dr. P. Savita from NetProfan Chennai chapter is an assistant professor in School of Food Science, MOP Vaishnav College for Women in Chennai. She's graduated with MSc, MPhil and PhD from Avinashalingam University, Coimbatore, and has a teaching experience of more than 15 plus years. And she has been guiding several postgraduates and MPhil scholars in their research work as well. She has done several article publications in national and international journals to her credit, and also authored chapters in medical books on medical nutrition therapy. She is active in designing new curriculum and implementing new concepts. She consistently strives to create a challenging learning environment and also nurture the young minds in taking up various job avenues in the food industry, besides inculcating entrepreneur skills in the food-based sector. Ma'am is also a life member of professional bodies like Association of Food Scientists and Technologists, AFSTI, Nutrition Society of India, NSI, and Indian Diabetic Association, IDA. She has organized international national conferences, workshops, and seminars beside her participation. She's currently the secretary for AFSTI, Chennai chapter. She's also received Best Paper Awards at International and National Conference of Diabetes in Pregnancy Study Group, DIPSI, as well as IDA and NSI. So good evening, ma'am, once again, and thank you very much for joining us.
Good evening, Nisha. Thank you. Yeah. Good evening to all. Thank you, Nisha, for that nice words of introduction.
Yeah, you're welcome, ma'am.
Yes. I will just share my screen. Yes.
Yeah. I'll just turn my mic and my video off, ma'am, so you can take over, okay?
Yes. Thank you.
I'll be here if you need anything. Okay.
Yes, thank you. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Good evening, one and all. It is rather a pleasant task and a great evening to be with you all. So first and foremost, I would like to thank the organizers, Universal Society of Food and Nutrition, and the Chennai chapter of NetProfan and AFST Chennai for having given me this great task of addressing on this relevant topic on the present situation. So it is in sync with the present situation, food adulteration, consumer awareness, and mitigation strategies. So we as a forum, both at Universal Society of Food and Nutrition, AFSTI and NetProfan, we are a network of professionals who have a great task ahead in bringing all the linkage or bringing a platform to link all the food technologists, food scientists, nutritionists, academia, students, industry, research scholars, and professionals. So to highlight more, we have a huge task of working along with all of them as a team, as part of several associations, as NetProfan involves a lot of associations like IDA, NSI, AFSTI, Indian Culinary Chefs Association, Indian Chemical Industry Organization Association, and so many. So at this juncture, where we are in the midst of a pandemic, as well as we are in the current festive season, this topic, food adulteration, to make the consumer more aware of what is happening around us, is more relevant, and it's appropriate to deal with this topic or deliberate more on this topic for today. I hope you have a very useful session with this deliberation, and I wish you all a good evening once again, and thanks to the organizers. So before going to the task of talking about this food adulteration, I think all are very much aware, as living beings, we rely on food and water for basic survival. You know, that is one of the basic necessities of mankind. And the post-COVID-19 world, you know, COVID-19, we don't know when it is going to end, but post-COVID-19 world is set to see an increased focus on food safety. And this is exactly the scenario the world is facing today. So thanks to the intensive agriculture, globalization of food trade, mass catering, and street foods, our food safety is a big question mark. Both technology and innovations have all come up. So our main idea of food safety is to bring safe and nutritious food to the plate of the customer. But there are several menus and several things that are a hindrance to it, where ultimately it leads to the hazard in the health of the customers. So talking about food, food for sustenance of life, it, all of you all know as food scientists or nutritionists or researchers or academia, it plays a very major sustaining role. And we as human beings, we have full rights, all rights to a pure, fresh and healthy diet for maintaining good health. And in order to access to the sufficient amount of safe and nutritious food, we need, for sustaining our life, we need, for promoting our good health, it is our right to get proper food and good food and healthy food. So community health is nation's health. We can achieve community health only if each one of us are healthy and each one of us make a family and each family is healthy, then we can go to on saying we have reached community health. And once we have reached community health, we would rather be reaching the nation's wealth. So food safety is inextricably linked to good health. So what is food? As per the scientific definition, food means any substance. It can be a raw material, it can be processed, it can be partially processed or unprocessed, which is intended for human consumption. So as per the FSSA Act, that is Food Safety and Standards Act 2006, we have to first clearly understand what is food safety. Food safety means assurance that food is acceptable for human consumption according to its intended use. Here you have to pay heed to two important words. One is human consumption and the next one is intended use. So only if the food is ready to eat or acceptable to eat, then we can tell yes, it is ready or fit for human consumption. At the same time, it should be intended to its use. Intended to its use in the sense it's edible, it's safe, it is of standard, it is of use, full use to our life, to our health, to our body and mind. So it is a scientific discipline. Rather, food safety can be told as a scientific discipline. It describes handling, preparation, storage of food, and in all ways where we prevent foodborne illness. So this COVID-19 pandemic has brought the aspect of food safety to the forefront. And we have to be really have a clear understanding of what happens when the consumption of food, which is a necessity, is considered risky and deemed unsafe. So what do you mean by unsafe food? We have seen what is safe food. We have seen what is food. We have seen what is food safety. Are we not ready to understand what is unsafe food? Yes, it is an article of food whose nature, substance or quality is so affected, but it is so affected that it renders injury to health. So it can be an article by itself, a food material as it is. Maybe it is grown from the farm, it's a raw material, raw. It is in a raw form. It can be composed. It can be a whole material or a part of a material. It can lead to a deleterious substance presence or it can lead to poison. So in all that matter, we tell that food is unsafe. It can contain wholly or part of it some filthy material, some putrefaction, rotten or decomposed or diseased matter, either of plant origin or animal origin. Again, it is unsafe. Then by virtue of its unhygienic processing, presence of any harmful substance, again, it's unsafe. So substitution of either inferior or cheaper substance, whether whole or in part, this is what actually happens in the topic that we are going to deliberate. Then addition of any substance directly as an ingredient, which is not permitted. So please understand the fact, it is not permitted. If it is in permitted elements, okay, fine, we are safe. But the abstraction wholly or in part or any of its constitutions, and food article being colored. So we are all taken away, especially children are taken away by artificial coloring, flavoring, coating, powdering, polishing. So all this are causing in some way or the other directly or indirectly damage to the food that we eat and therein by our health. So the presence of any coloring matter or preservatives that are added or some infections of worms or weevils or insects or cockroach, anything that is there in the food, any food article being prepared or packed under insanitary conditions. Sanitation is a very important phenomena these days, at least like we had in the pandemic where so much and so forth we talk about social distancing, we talk about sanitary conditions and how safe we have to have all our sanitary surroundings. By the article being misbranded or substandard. So this is the actual meaning of the word adulteration. So the article, food article is being misbranded or substandard or food containing extraneous matter. So So the food article, in case it contains pesticides or other contaminants, again we tell it is unsafe. So this unsafe food is giving us a rather very bad health impact. So unsafe food has health impact, less non-health impact. Of course, we know a lot of health impact starting from so many diseases till toxic conditions. What is this non-health impact? It has some association with economy of our country too. So food supply chain, now it is crossing countries. We are no more limiting our supply chains to the borders. We are exceeding the borders. We are going with export and import, and nowhere we are stopping with our own local resources. We are going multinational, overseas. So multiple national borders it is crossing. And new threats are constantly emerging due to changes in food distribution or production or consumption. And infections are caused due to this consumption of unsafe food, and it has a very big impact on the population, especially with poor people, with people with fragile health, infants, elderly, etc., are severe and very fatal. And if you see the key facts, what's happening in the present scenario, food poses a global health threat endangering everyone. So it is not only threat to our country, it is a global health threat. It endangers the life of everyone. It creates rather a vicious cycle of disease and malnutrition, especially infants, young children, pregnant women, the elderly, and those people with the underlying illness. These are also the risky group in which the COVID-19 attacks. So an estimated 600 million, almost, that is 1 in 10 people in the world, they fall ill after eating contaminated food, and 420,000 die every year, resulting in the loss of 33 million healthy life years. The point to be noted is it is not just 33 million life, it is 33 million healthy life. That means the productive age group is being affected. Productivity is lost. Unsafe food also contains harmful bacteria, virus, parasites, chemical substances, and it causes more than 200 diseases. It can be from a simple diarrhea to exotic cancers. So one menace that is majorly contributing to this unsafe food is food adulteration. So we have to clearly understand what is this adulteration. Adulteration, as per the scientific definition, is addition of any extraneous matter, the matter that is not needed or something that's unwanted to food in its supply chain, either in procurement or processing or preparation, which makes the food substandard as well as it makes it unsafe. It is done intentionally by some unscrupulous food business operators for financial gain. We have to really understand why people are going in for this food adulteration. So it is intentionally done by some unscrupulous food business operators for financial gain. And adulteration causes serious health problem, and it's a menace. And it occurs globally in many facets, affecting all the food commodities. So it is not in one product or the other just for us to ignore and keep walking away. It is there in almost all the commodities. And it is not only constitutes an economic problem, as already stated, but leads to serious health issues for consumers. And all the methods of adulterating food have become so sophisticated. So it's high time we develop, as scientists, as technologists, we develop efficient and reliable techniques for the detection of these fraudulent manipulations, and we have to fight it against. So if you see the sources of food contamination, it can be the raw materials, it can be through water. Water is severely essential for all the food in the making. We need water to drink, to live. There is some contamination in the air, in the dust, air pollution, water pollution. There is contaminants in the soil, excess use of pesticides, insecticides, manure, chemical manure, then garbage and sewage. So again, here in this arena also, we are facing a lot of contamination issues. And especially in the winter season or the monsoon season, still more, it is more severe. Presence of rodents, insects, then animals, birds, their excreta, unwanted material from them. Then packaging material, we'll be dealing exclusively for packaging material in the course of our presentation. And last, food handlers or man. So it can transmit from man to man, it can transmit from man to food. And especially this is very important for food handlers at home, at the kitchen, at food service operators, restaurants, hotel industry, canteens, school, hostels, college institutions, canteens, everything, where from our human aspect, the transmission goes to the food by means of wrong storage, wrong temperature storage in your refrigerator, how you store your cooked food, uncooked food, raw food, or each different type of food requires different temperature. temperature. So when is food said to be adulterated? You have inferior or cheap substances substituted, then you tell it is adulterated. The constituent are wholly or partly abstracted, or an article is prepared, packed, or kept in insanitary conditions, or there is rotten, decomposed, or insects in the material. This already we have seen, poisonous ingredient, colored substance, excessive preservative, and above all, if the standard of the food is not maintained, which is very, very important. What would be the reasons for adulteration? We can see the main reason or motive behind this adulteration is to earn more profits. So to increase the volume of trade by showing the lower prices. When supply is less than demand, so we have enormous demand in our present situation, especially globally and in the Indian scenario, our population is so much increasing. We have 10 million mouths to feed, but where there is so much of this demand, the supply is very less. So the shortage of supply, which in fact intunes the food manufacturers or traders to go into adulteration. To cut down the product cost to meet the market competition. In shortage of authentic ingredients at affordable prices. In shortage of qualified personnel and no updation of processing techniques. So we need to have some qualified personnel for making the food standard. Inadequate knowledge and the consequences and associated food safety risk. Both inadequate knowledge from the consumer angle as well as inadequate knowledge from the traders or the food manufacturers or the retailers or the sellers. And lack of awareness and updation of the information about adulteration and in regard to food safety outbreaks. Some may do it intentionally, some may do it accidentally, some may do it incidentally. So all this, the ultimate outcome of all this is health hazard or health risk. So coming to types of adulteration, we largely have three different types of adulteration. Intentional, that is done for financial gain on purpose. They know their intention is to adulterate and make money or to make profit. Addition of sand, marble, stones, chips, mud, filth, tar, chalk powder, water, mineral oil, harmful color, and so on and so on. What is this incidental adulteration? It happens due to carelessness or lack of proper hygienic conditions, processing, storage, transportation, and marketing. So pesticide residues may be there, droppings of birds, animals, rodents, larvae, and foods, all these come under incidental. What is this metallic adulteration? It occurs due to arsenic from pesticides. So it can be lead from water, effluent from chemical industries, it can be from tin from cans. And this mainly largely pertains to packaging material and the packaged foods. If you look at the food adulteration categories, three types of categories are there. One is replacement. So complete or a partial replacement of a food ingredient or valuable authentic constituent. It can be a less expensive substitute. But there is an intention of adding it, and thereby they circumvent on the origin and false declaration of the process. So there's something called claims. If you see the packaging material, if you look at the food products on the label, you can see these false claims. In fact, we can sue those people who have made this false claim. Only thing we need to be first aware of, what we need to know before we sue them. Addition of small amounts of non-authenticated substances to mask inferior quality ingredient. And of course, removal. What they tend to do is they remove off the high costly or quality material and replace it with substandard or cheap material and they sell it at a higher rate. So without the purchaser's knowledge. So this is also done very intentionally, which needs to be really curbed. Especially coming to the festive season scenario that we are in amidst. So first thing is many of our, the sweets or savories or relishes or delicacies that we make during the festive season is mainly from milk. And largely we know we have been reading through the media and papers and all that there's a lot of contamination in milk and milk products, especially in our country. Milk is rather adulterated, it is watery. So many ingredients are added to it to make it adulterated. So here, the rampant adulteration of milk and milk products happens during Diwali, especially every year. I think 2 days back, our season is over, but still we are in the festive mood. Sweets and savories are there at part and parcel of the food in every household. And market players adulterate the milk products. Why? Because they have to meet the sudden rise in the demand, especially during the festive season. So milk is a shortage. So Indian festivals definitely are going to be incomplete without sweets, especially with a lot of milk and milk products used like ghee, koya, mava and others. And over the several years, it has been observed that This adulteration of milk and milk products is rampant during the Diwali season as demand shoots up and market players really fool people by selling adulterated milk products. Few of the products of milk that are adulterated are milk, paneer, khoya, and ghee. And how these are adulterated, you have to know the knowledge is milk and milk products like paneer, khoya, ghee, rabdi, and sweet curd, they're adulterated with starch, urea, vanaspati, formalin, sulfuric acid, coal tar dyes, and blotting paper. So you can see the nature of ingredients going into our milk. The aforementioned substances also improve the appearance and storage of the milk products, but causing a great compromise on the health of the consumers. While starch and vanaspati are tame adulterants, coal tar dyes contain heavy metals that can potentially damage the brain, and this is the reason for many toxins that are developing in our body and leading to diseases like cancer. So check the presence of adulterants. We have a lot of tests which we'll be dealing in the upcoming slides. So this is just an example for milk products. So you want to test for starch in the milk. You boil a small quantity of khoya. After cooling it, add a few drops of iodine solution. If starch is present, it indicates a blue coloration appears. Same way, formalin is present. You have to add a few ml of concentrated sulfuric acid around the sides of the container, and a violet ring that forms at the intersection of two liquids that shows the presence of formalin. And if you want to have just a physical test of khoya without going in for a chemical test, it is, you know, normally pure khoya is greasy and tastes sweet. So rub a small sample, taste to it, and check its tartness and sweetness before buying. The only thing, we have to take initiatives, and we should not be lazy to go in for these type of tests before we purchase. So these are the list of common milk adulterants and their harmful effects. So for milk, of course, all of you know water is added to increase the milk volume. So benzoic acid and salicylic acid is also added. It increases shelf life for long distance transport. Detergents are added, you know, detergents rather cause a foamy and lather content in the milk. It increases the whiteness and thickness. Urea provides whiteness and increases the consistency of milk and improves the SNF in milk. Formalin increases the shelf life. Starch increases the quantity. It maintains the SNF in synthetic milk. And you can see the damages that each one of these adulterant causes. So starting from minor damages to major damages, gastrointestinal problems, renal problems, liver problems, kidney damage, diarrhea, even sometimes fatal for illness conditions. Other than milk, some adulterated foods are there in the market, like turmeric, dals, pulses. So, you know, in turmeric, you have methanol yellow, kesari dal that is being adulterated with ordinary dal. Then you have green chilies, green peas, and other green vegetables. They are coated with malachite green and argemone seeds to give you a dark green color. Mustard seeds and mustard oil is being adulterated with argemone seeds and papaya seeds. And if you, again, paneer khoya, we have seen ice cream, which is a fantasy for many children. Adulterant is pepperonyl, ethyl acetate, butyldehyde, nitrate, washing powder is being used, and all these are causing a serious health hazard. Coffee powder, again, tamarind seeds, chicory powder is being added on pure coffee seeds, and which also leads to a lot of health hazards, including severe joint pain. Look at the beverages. I think in India, we are all tuned to two beverages, mainly tea and coffee. So the adulterants used in tea or dye or artificial color or even iron fillings, you know, iron fillings and all are being used in the tea leaves, which would not be obvious to in the naked eye. So while if you observe the tea leaves by putting it on, spreading it on the surface, you can see even iron fillings sometimes. And they're also adulterated with suppose you buy loose tea, it is not safe to buy loose tea because it's better to buy packaged tea. Loose tea also has a lot of chances of having all these substances. And used tea from tea stalls, you know what they do? They dry it in the sun, they mix it with coal tar dye, and they add some genuine amount of original tea and give it a flavor, and they use it as a fresh tea leaves. So we have to be very careful. Coffee is considered a drink of delight, and even that is not spared. It is mixed with chicory powder, ground tamarind, and date seeds. And all these causes a lot of health hazard, including diarrhea, and it causes stomach disorders, giddiness, joint pain, nervous weakness, and all. And ground coffee is mixed with cheap ingredients like maize, soya bean, sugar, and these unwanted extras aren't harmful. They can spoil the quality and the taste. Product. So some might be a hazard, but some might really absolutely affect the taste of the product. And tea is also adulterated with Prussian blue, a non-soluble blue pigment used to color the blueprints, the crayon paintings, paint. All these are non-toxic to humans, but it may affect the taste and quality of the product. Indigo, a blue dye derived from the indigo plant. Then graphite, it is also a naturally occurring mineral in the form of carbon. It is used in lead and pencils. It's also adulterated for tea. Gypsum, a soft naturally occurring mineral, is used to alter the color of tea. Turmeric powder, day-to-day uses in our daily kitchen. So it is adulterated with a lot of non-permitted colorants like metallic yellow, staphylococcus starch, lead chromate powder and all. If you take chili powder, I think you would have heard that chili powder is usually contaminated with red brick powder, Sudan, grit, sand, dirt, non-permitted colors and sawdust. Poultry and fish, coming to these animal food products. They are mixed with formalin and other types of chemicals and which are used to keep the food fresh, and they are injurious to health. And it causes different types of cancers, asthma and skin diseases. And unhygienic meat and meat products can cause food infection, even sometimes to the extent of fever and chill, you know. And it is a real nuisance to the public health. Mercury and in mercury contaminated fish can cause brain damage, paralysis and even sometimes death. Food additives. I think all of you have heard about additives. So there's a lot of things between food adulteration and food additives. These additives are chemical substances that are added to processed foods. They help to enhance or to retain the quality attributes such as texture, physical properties, taste, flavor, etc. And we need to control the spoilage. In order to control the spoilage and enhance the shelf life of the processed foods also, they have been added. And they have been added in several forms. They have been added as antioxidants. They have been added as emulsifiers, stabilizers, preservatives, artificial sweeteners, bulking agents or acid regulators, flavor enhancers and glazing agents. So we can tell that all additives need not be adulterants if present within the specific limits. In case they exceed the specific limit, they become significant adulterants and they can cause a serious health hazard to the consumers. And all additives are not adulterants until reported outbreak of food safety issues. We won't know whether this is causing us a great problem, because only if there is an outbreak or if there's an illness that is caused or a whole entire people are affected, only then the news of the adulteration comes out. And several additives are there. We can list a lot of them. Synthetic colors that are being used, like tartrazine and saccharin and cyclamate, that are used in artificial sweeteners, where they can even go to the risk of causing cancer of urinary bladder when used in the long run. Even urticaria, runny nose, asthma, and nitrates and nitrites, they are used as preservatives in packaged meat, may cause stomach and gastrointestinal cancers. And MSG, a very known Ajinomoto. It is used as a food flavor enhancer. It causes severe headache, asthma, nausea, and even neurological disorders, damage to the brain. Then you have sodium metabisulfate and sulfur dioxide. They are used in dry fruits, wines, beers to prevent discoloration and spoilage. Sulfur dioxide, this is also used as a preservative of fruits and vegetables and causes a lot of breathing problems. Of course, sweets. A lot of non-permitted colors, non-permitted dyes are all used. It may even lead to infertility, anemia, cancer, birth defects, and artificial colorings found in soda, fruit juices, and salad dressings. Children are more attracted towards these colors. So be it some bakery foods or chocolates or to the any products with sweet or carbonated beverages or drinks or fresh juices. Lot of behavioral problems arise in children taking this artificial coloring matter. It can lead to an extent of a significant reduction in their IQ. So we'll have to be very, very safe while we use these coloring matter foods from outside. What about ice cream? Ice cream, the adulterant is pepper oil, ethyl acetate, butyraldehyde, and washing powder. And they cause terrible diseases affecting lungs, kidneys, and heart. Food grains, the normal food grains, being rice and wheat, maize being the staple food in our country, they're all adulterated with sometimes starch, sometimes grains of stones, grits, and they do all this. Why do they do all this in these raw material food grains? Is they want to increase the overall weight per quintal and sell it to the bulk. And by this way, they make money. So, what about tomato sauce? I think this is a favorite product and that is stored in the refrigerators of all households. Tomato sauce is, we are taken away by the color, the taste, saltiness, tang, sweetness and all. Tomato sauce is mostly used in local fast food centers and artificially made from pumpkin pulp. They're made from sugar, non-edible colors and flavors, and very little amount of tomato. So the customer is deceived, consumer is deceived. These sauces with artificial colors and flavors are highly carcinogenic. Vegetable oils. See, now in the present day market, we have been given the opportunity of buying a lot of oils. So many oils have started coming up. And vegetable oils, like in mustard seeds and mustard oil, that in trend mostly seen, as I said earlier, the jajimon seeds, which are used to add bulk and weight. Papaya seeds that are used to add bulk, and also young children and senior citizens with pure immunity are more susceptible to the usage of these false foods, especially in the cooking oils. Packaging for that's very, very important part. So the nowadays, the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, FSSAI, has banned the use of plastic and newspapers for packaging of it. But there are low quality food grade plastic. Whenever we select this, we have to see that there are low quality food grade plastics are not used, and we go in for good type of ones. Polyethylene, polyvinyl chloride, and other allied compounds are used to produce flexible packaging material. And while this method of packaging is very convenient, it should not contain any noxious or thermal breakdown products which can cause injury to health. Further, temperatures used for sealing or sterilizing should not result in formation of toxic residues. So there's a lot of toxicity in the substance, and if you subject it to more of temperatures or sterilization or sealing, it will tend to eat the toxic out and pass it on to the food. Therefore, it is essential to use food-grade plastic packaging material for packaging food. Packaging requirements. As a consumer, you should be aware of what is the packaging requirement in the food samples that we procure from the market. Only food-grade quality material used for packaging, storing, or wrapping, or transportation, or sale, or service of food. Everything should be of food-grade quality. Even the ink that is used for printing on food should conform to IS 15495, which is a particular grading which will not cause any harm to our human. And printed surface of packaging material should not come in direct contact with the food product. Newspaper or any such material should not be used for storing or wrapping food. Often we see in the roadside, street vendors and all, just like that, even the budgie sold at the beachside and all, they just take a paper, a newspaper, they roll it at the. But we should know the harmful effects of it. Tin containers once used shall not be reused for packaging of food products. Should be clean, hygienic, tamper-proof bottles and containers. In case you find it tampered, you have to return it or you can report it and not use it. In case of multi-layer packaging, the layer which comes in contact with food shall meet the requirements of the packaging materials. So coming to the Indian situation, what is happening in India? We have seen roughly so far by now what are the things that are prevailing around with respect to adulteration, contamination, unsafe food and all. What is the situation in India? What are we doing? What is happening? So there is rampant food adulteration in India. Food adulteration has become a very, very common practice in our country, and we are still consuming these foods almost every day. Day in and day out, we can see that a lot of problems are erupting, and we have numerous harmful effects to our health. So this adulteration of food is becoming really unethical. It is becoming a social evil. And to say at large, it is becoming a slow poison. It is just like you're feeding poison to your body. And adulteration, it lowers the quality of the food, and it can be hazard to health, is what we have been repeatedly seeing. And these products are marketed in a very tricky manner. It is a very motive of cheating the customers. So what does our food laws say? Every country, there should be a regulatory body for food. In our country, FSSAI, strong laws against adulteration, are slowly stopping the small vendors, especially the street food vendors and businessmen, from cheating the customers. So what is this FSSAI? This FSSAI is the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India. They go by the FSSAI Act, which replaced the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act of 1954. So by this, they have made a paradigm shift from food adulteration to holistic, safe and wholesome food. That is what the consumers need. So they brought all the regulation and orders by various ministries. They brought it under one umbrella, that is Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So this is a statutory body. FSSAI is a statutory body. It governs the food safety of the country. It is an autonomous body. It is established under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Earlier, before the FSSAI Act 2006 was passed, we did have a lot of laws relating to the food. We did have the PFA Act, that is Prevention of Food Adulteration Act of 1954. We had the Food Products Order for fruits, for meat food product order for meat, edible oil packaging order for edible oils, vegetable oil product for vegetables, milk and milk product order for milk, and so on and so forth. But all these have been now brought under one umbrella under the FSSA Act 2006, and they take care of all these through their activities. So one important initiative as a consumer we need to be aware of is the various resources created by FSSAI to educate the consumers, to create awareness among the customers. And one such important of the several initiatives taken by FSSAI is the release of the DART resource material to the public. That is, DART stands for Detect Adulteration with Rapid Test. It is a PDF, it is a resource material, it's a booklet that has been released by FSSAI. It is there on their FSSAI website. And very common, quick, simple test for detection of food adulterants, such as artificial colors, toxic material, toxic colors, extraneous matter, everything can be done by simple, even household housewives, by children, by all common people. It can be there at every household level, at the restaurants, at the industry, everywhere. So we would have a look at what is this DART. So the purpose of this manual is to list out common methodologies available for food adulterants generally in India. And the scope of this manual is generally for all households to induce awareness among the consumer about food safety. And FSSAI, how does it has created the content for this manual is it conducted several tests for different type of adulterants, maybe chemical, microbiological, through FSSAI notified labs across the country. These labs are called NABL labs, national accredited labs accredited by FSSAI. The above tests require highly trained personnel and sophisticated equipment, and there are common adulterants and contaminants that can be tested by citizens themselves. So through these people, they have brought about simple techniques test that we can easily do it at home to check the adulteration. So it's a compilation of such tests for detecting the adulterants, and it's quite rapid. Immediately you get the result, and you're able to identify artificial matter, toxic colors, extraneous matter. And they did this resource material with the help of an expert team from scientists from ITC Life Sciences and Technology Center. So it is very, very reliable. It is often being used. And the areas they've covered under this DART is for all the areas. They've not left out any food items. They have covered milk and milk products, oils and fats, sugars and confectionaries, food grains and products, fruits and vegetables, spices and beverages. A lot of 50 to 60 tests are available in this material. You can look at it at the FSSAI portal at the website. I have brought few tests to you through these presentation slides so that you be aware. We'll go one by one. For milk and milk products, as you have seen what all it gets affected with, there are simple tests to detect water. You need to put a drop of milk on a polished slanting surface. Pure milk either stays or flows slowly, leaving a white trail behind. But if it is adulterated milk, water will flow immediately without leaving a mark. That itself shows it's adulterated milk. How can you check detergent? Take 5 to 10 ml of the sample with equal amount of water. Shake the contents thoroughly. If milk is adulterated with detergent, it will form dense lather. Pure milk will form very thin foam layer due to agitation. So that gives the presence of detergent. So same way, you can do it for starch, you can do it for urea, you can do it for vanaspati, you can do it for synthetic milk. Synthetic milk gives a soapy feeling when rubbed between fingers. Also, it turns yellow on heating. So these simple techniques, you can do it before you consume such products. And there are some physical and chemical tests for paneer. Physical test for paneer is it is usually soft and can withstand pressure. It is going to be pure paneer. So when you apply pressure on it with your hands, adulterated paneer will break into small pieces, indicating the presence of baking soda. And chemical test, you put a boil a paneer sample with some water, cool, and then add a few drops of iodine solution. The color changes to blue. That means starch is present. So all these tests you can go through in the DART booklet at the FSSAI website. Check of presence of adulterants in ghee. Ghee is adulterated with coal tar dye, vanaspati, potatoes. And already we have seen HCl and H2SO4, hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid being tested, coal tar dyes in vanaspati. Even ghee is contaminated with mashed potatoes. So you take a few drops of iodine to ghee, if brownish color changes to pink, that means starch is present. That means your ghee is adulterated with mashed potatoes. Then for sugars and confectionery, detection of sugar solution in honey. Honey is another one common product in the household. So take a transparent glass, add a drop of honey to the glass. Pure honey will not disperse in water. The drop of honey disperses in water, it indicates the presence of added sugar. What about food grains and products? Take few food grains. Take again water, put few teaspoons of the food grains. pure food grains will not leave any color. If it is adulterated color, immediately you will have the color in the water. Same way, deduction of kesari dal and dal whole and split. Take few quantity of dal in a plate and examine the impurities visually. You can see the shape of the kesari dal is different. It has an edged type appearance showing a slant on one side or a square in appearance. It can be separated out by close examination. So all these are simple techniques which you can do it at your household level. And deduction of papaya seeds in black pepper. Again, take the same amount of black pepper to a glass of water. Pure black pepper settles at the bottom. If it is going to be adulterated black pepper, papaya seeds float on the surface of water. Same way for turmeric powder. Artificial turmeric, it leaves the color of the water, whereas pure turmeric, it stays settling down. Adulterated turmeric will leave strong yellow color water while settling down. So you should check for all these. What about the green color in the vegetables? Deduction of malachite green in green chili and green vegetables. For testing method, take a cotton piece, soak it in water and drop the outer part of surface of vegetables. You can see the cotton turning green, which shows the presence of malachite green. Same way for peas. You put some peas in a glass of water, you soak it for half an hour, you will see the separation of the color in the water, which shows the presence of the artificial color of peas. Beverages, chicory powder and coffee powder. Take a transparent glass of water, add a teaspoon of coffee powder. Coffee powder floats over the water, but chicory begins to settle. Same way, exhausted tea leaves. Take a filter paper, spread some tea leaves, sprinkle with water to wet the filter paper. Wash the filter paper under tap water and you will observe the stains and against light. If it is pure tea leaves, no stain will be there. If coal tar is present, it will immediately stain the filter paper. And miscellaneous items, again, you want to check for common salt and iodized salt. You cut a piece of potato, add salt and wait for a minute. Add 2 drops of lemon juice. If it is iodized salt, blue color will develop. And in the case of common salt, there will be no color. Deduction of wax polishing on apple. Everywhere we have been seeing this problem, especially while we give such foods to the elderly, to children, to pregnant women and all. Take a blade and scratch the surface of the apple. Wax comes out if wax polishing has been done. So you could see the extent of which the consumers are being cheated by these traders and food producers. So this is the dark potent. So these are a few examples that I've stated. There are so many other tests like these for several products. Please browse through this website, go through the dark potent and save it and as a PDF in your important document, because that is going to really make you aware of the consumer awareness on food adulteration. And we do at the end of the book, there is also a few quick tests for establishing tentative authentication of food products by sensory evaluation. So by mere sensory test, you could find out whether it is adulterated. So this site can be accessed at www.fssi.gov.in/. So please go through the website for more elaborate information. Apart from this DART book, the FSSI under the Eat Right India movement, which was launched in 2018, are doing a massive campaign to combat food adulteration. They have come out with Food Safety Magic Box. Magic Box is a kit. So 100 test of food adulteration for school children, they can do simply through in the schools or at home. And it's very safe to use and all. The entire kit is going to help them to detect few adulterants. And apart from that, FSSI launched Food Safety on Wheels. So we cannot, consumer cannot be going and identify which are the labs he can go and test the food. So they came out with mobile food testing labs. So these mobile units go around the city and you can go take your ingredient or a sample and go get it tested. And apart from that, they have given accreditation to 275 test labs for doing the test. So these are all FSSI accredited labs. These are reliable and you can go do the testing there also. So this magic box is, apart from magic box for school students, they also has come out with lesson plan booklet for deduction of adulteration in food samples for grade-wise lesson plans from grade 3 to 10. So it gives a detailed information on how to conduct the test to check for food adulteration. This is also available in the FSSI website under Eat Right School. So please watch and get adequate information. Okay, having seen what the FSSI is doing, it is also going, the state food authorities and food department, safety department and the central authorities of FSSI are going around nook and corner and they are doing, in a very rampant way, they are doing checking of adulteration. So random sampling is also done. It is not systemized, it is random. Only random sampling helps to identify what sort of a adulteration is there in which part of material. If you go through some news clippings and papers, you can see news information like this and spots. And in your food, chemicals are added, colors are added, calcium carbide is used to ripen fruits like mangoes, bananas, copper sulfate is used to ripen fruits, oxytocin, which is a hormone used for faster growth of pumpkin, watermelon. Well, look at the elaborate hazard, and wax that's added to apples and pears, and cheap colors that are contributing to the vegetable's color, and saccharin used to sweeten even the watermelons, with artificial sweetening using saccharin, pesticides and herbicides used excessively. So the ultimate health hazards, a lot of digestive system disorders, disorder in the eye, liver, and all the stuff, and vomiting, diarrhea, kidney failure, damage to the brain. So simple things are advocated, as we all know, you and me know, wash fresh and fruits, vegetables in lukewarm water before eating, and more so we are following all these things in the present COVID scenario. Use locally grown fruits and vegetables, don't go in for products that are cultivated outside our country. So go local, go seasonal, use our own food products, always wash hands before preparing meals or before eating. Remove and discard outer leaves of lettuce and cabbage. Do not use the outer layers of food. So if you see at the present report of FSSAI, which was released just 2 weeks back, they have given the report for 2018-19 that 28% of the food samples that were tested were found to be adulterated or substandard. So this report was analyzed by CNBC-TV18. It indicates a consistent rise in instances of food adulteration in the country. They have tested nearly 106,459 food samples through the NABL labs, and they have found 28.56% were found to be non-confirming. UP and Jharkhand continues to be among the top 5 states with the highest adulteration rates over the 3 years. So you can see the next to it is Tamil Nadu there, and next to UP, Tamil Nadu is ranked second with 45% and Jharkhand with 41%. So the proportion of adulterated or misbranded food has really doubled in 8 years. While you see the 2012-13 data, only 15% of the food samples were tested were non-confirming, but now it has gone to double. And FSSAI splits these non-confirming samples into 3 categories, that is unsafe, substandard, and those with labeling defects. A large chunk of the samples analyzed by the FSSAI public labs falls under the substandard category. So we cannot tell it is adulterated, but they fall into a category called substandard. That means it is not of the regular standard. It is, however, imperative to note that 28% of the food sold in India is adulterated, but this indicates that 1/3 of the samples that are collected pan-India were found to be non-conforming, non-conforming in the sense non-conforming to the standards. So the food safety officers in each state, they regularly collect random samples of milk, water, packaged food, and they check for quality. And also states like UP and Jharkhand, they have been reporting high adulteration over the past 3 years. And if you see present, it is, as I told you, Tamil Nadu also has a say in this. And states with the lowest adulteration rates include Arunachal Pradesh, Goa, and Uttarakhand. So the minimum is in Arunachal Pradesh, next in Uttarakhand, and the next minimum is in Goa. And why does this happen? Why does this adulteration happen? If you look, glyphosate is also playing a key role in identifying the root of this menace. So by reading through the reports and identifying and doing some studies and research, it has been found there's a huge gap in supply and demand, as already we discussed. So food safety is an aim to bring safe and nutritious food to the plate of the customer, but the prime objective of the food is not suffice because of this menace created by food adulteration. And as we have already discussed, it is the selfish interest of the food vendors for monetary gains. And we are not only compromising the health of the consumers, but a large portion of the food is wasted. If you find a food adulterated, what do? We discard it. So ultimately food waste. So how do we meet the demand and supply if we are going to waste this large amount of food? And the country which faces a gap in the supply and demand like India, we have to go several steps back again because of this problem. And so FSSAI campaign for consumer awareness by releasing this DART book, it is trying its level best to identify the roots of this problem. And also this detection of food adulteration is just one side of the coin. It is to be made sure that the sources of such adulterants are identified and penalized. Of course, there's a lot of penalties that has been given, the cancellation of the FSSAI license that's been happening, but still apart from all these measures, stringent measures are being taken, still the adulteration is prevailing. And a large number of products, both packaged and unpackaged, we are found to be adulterated if we are testing it in the food laboratories, and it simply goes wasted from the lab. So you can see the extent of wastage. You know, the food is on one side, the very striving farmer, he's growing the food with multitude of his resources. But on the other side, this food is not reaching safely to the consumer, and it is reaching the plate only as a non-standard. So who are to be blamed? The middlemen who are doing the heinous crimes. You know, the more of the 10 billion people of Indian population number, more than 2 billion are nearly 2 to 3 billion are really, they're not able to even find the needs for 2 square meals in a day. But more than half of the food that is being prepared or cultivated or grown is being wasted because of food adulteration. Food wastage and violation of the interest of the consumer who pays for the product, as well as the farmers who work hard to grow the crop. Consumer is losing his money on one side, the farmer is losing his hard-earned work that is being given to produce a crop. So to prevent food adulteration, we need to have regular surveillance. Still more surveillance is happening, but still more stringent surveillance, monitoring, inspection, random samplings are to be taken by the food safety officers of the states and union territories. And action has to be initiated against the defaulters of food business operators. And to ensure availability of good quality foodstuffs, strict vigil has to be maintained from all corners, that is the manufacturers, wholesalers, retailers, action against offenders under provisions of the FSSA Act 2006. And FSSA has strengthened the food testing ecosystem by accrediting a lot of labs, 263 to now 275 plus labs. And that book initiative is there on the website for you all to be aware of. And it has also introduced a policy for adoption of rapid analytical food testing, that is a RAFT kit or equipment or method for regulatory purpose. So what will be the possible remedies? We as a consumer for look into the remedies of this problem, of this huge menace. So we need to have improved storage facilities, especially countries like India, developing countries like India. The storage facilities, especially for the freshly grown grains or the raw material or the fruits and vegetables, is not proper. So proper storage systems have to be delivered with proper temperatures, and there should be also storage vehicles, as in countries like our developed countries. We need to have refrigerated storage vehicles where we can safeguard the items that are produced. And we need to improve the handling practices. Hygiene has to be followed right from palm to fork. Even handling practices of the mothers or the people in the kitchen has to be really monitored and supervised. Prevention of addition of extraneous matter for monetary gains, that is selling cheaper quality at food high prices, that should be really taken away from the minds of the vendors. There is a training called Fast Track training given by FSSAI. This is food safety training and certification. This training is given for everybody, even for students, for academia, for industry people, for researchers, for food industry people, for street vendors. We at AFSTI, our association of food scientists and technologists, and NetProfan, we also we work with FSSAI in giving fast track training with experienced panel, empaneled training members who have been supported by FSSAI to give food safety training and certification programs. There are a lot of levels of training for basic, for manufacturing, for seafoods, for oil, like that. So this fast-track training can be given especially to the street vendors. Even very last year, we had our project under FSTI where we plan to give fast-track training to street vendors of different parts of Chennai, and especially the vendors in the beach area, the Mahabalipuram area and all. But due to the COVID, we couldn't implement it. We are looking in for normal scenario to return where then we can implement that training. Newer technologies for detection of food adulteration should be implemented. You adopt simple test measures to do it yourself, just like the DART, and encourage the food vendors who are found to be fair. That means there should be some demarcation between who are fair, who are unfair. So those who are unfair, we are going to punish them, penalize them. But what are we doing for the ones who are fair? So what we could do is encourage them, give them some awards, give them some recognition, or boost their, give them free training or fast track, or do something so that we really give them, encourage them to do still more fair in their practices of food selling. And education to food vendors and all middlemen. As we mentioned earlier, it is the middlemen who are playing between the farmers and consumers. So this middlemen had to be really get educated. They should be penalized for their action. Stringent measures have to be strictly passed, not only from the government side, but also from the public side. So what are the do's to curb adulteration at individual level? Check for the food packets before you buy them. Very, very important. How many of us read the label information before we buy the product? If you go to the developed countries like America and all, you can see even a small child, while it picks up a product from the market, it just goes through the label information. But we as educated people, we don't even look at the label. We just look at the expiry date or the date of manufacture and we take it. There are a lot of other details that has to be read from the label. Inform others if you find something wrong. Don't keep it on to yourself. Spread awareness regarding food adulteration. Stand out and raise your voice instead of accepting a harmful product. You know, many customers do not raise their voice. They just simply keep things to themselves and it is not shown out. Use prescribed medicines by the doctor only. You know, these fraudsters have not even left our infant food behind. They have not even spared the medicines or drugs. So everything has been adulterated. So use prescribed medicines by the doctors alone. Don't do your self-medication. The manufacturers and companies must provide and confirm the authenticity and source of the products and their components. So they should, you should see to that all these information is available on the labels. Strengthening the communication between food item sellers, agencies, and government authorities. So who can do this is only you as consumers. So we need to play a role of a liaison between the government and the food producers and the farmers. And we need to strengthen the communication of all these that are happening. So consumer rights. Here you have to know about, each and every consumer has to know his rights. As a consumer, be aware of your rights with regard to food and food products and exercise your rights. So if you say, suppose you're a purchaser of a food article, you desire to have the article analyzed by a food analyst as per provisions of the FSSA Act. You shall pay the prescribed fee, which will be refunded if the food sample is substandard. So you go give the product. If you find the product to be adulterated or misbranded or contaminated, or it is not conforming to the standards, you can really get back the refund of the fees paid, and the manufacturer can be sued. And labeling, as talked earlier, it is mandatory that every package of food intended for sale should carry a label that bears all information required under the Food Safety and Sanitation Act. That is the Packaging and Regulation 2011 Act. So there are few things as a food smart consumer you need to do. This is a complete guide to food safety. It is also there at the FSSA website. Don't judge a food package. Read the labels before buying. So you can even not only see the manufacturing expiry date, you can see the offers that are given, the claims that are made, the net content of it, the manufacturer address, the license number, FSSA license number, what are all the additions or additives or preservatives that are added, everything. Any trans fats that is present, any sugar that is present, the salt that is present. So food labels should carry the following information: name of the food, the list of the ingredients, the nutritional information, month and year of packing, manufacturing, best before date, expiry date, whether it is a vegetarian with a green dot or the non-vegetarian that is symbolized with a red dot, and even some more informations are there. So one important highlight I would like to make here is you need to be aware of the app that is being advocated by the FSSAI. You need to be a food smart consumer. What you need to do immediately today itself, I want you all to download the Smart Consumer app. So this Smart Consumer app is available in the Play Store. So you can read the smart buying guides from there. You can stay connected with the Food Safety Connect FSSA mobile app. This is another app where it's called Food Safety Connect FSSA mobile app. It instantly empowers you to raise a food grievance with the authority. You can as well send consumer feedback, queries, concerns, comments, and complaints. There is a toll-free number for FSSA. There is an email for FSSI, and this is the FSSA government Delhi central office address. They have offices at the four different regions, Eastern, Western, Southern, and North. So you can get connected through the app immediately. Today, while you download the Smart Consumer app, you can look in for all the guidance that you need as a food consumer. So this Smart Consumer app is really a connect between the consumer and the manufacturer. And more than 2 lakh consumer products have been scanned so far through the Smart Consumer app after it was launched. And even if, say, suppose your product, you take a product and you don't find the product barcode label, or it is not legible. I'll say, suppose for an example that is given here, if the barcode label on your hand sanitizer is illegible, you want to know the details before purchase, just scan through the Smart Consumer app and you will be able to know the product, whether it is genuine, whether they've got FSSA license. And please look for standards logo, like FSSI logo, license number, AgMark symbol for if it is agricultural produce, marketing produces, ISI if it is ISI standards, and all product standard labels or logos. While you once read the Smart Consumer app, that you will know what all you need to get refurbished with. So the call for action is, Now, the trend is, especially in this COVID scenario, people have started to order online. So should you buy cheap food online? Consumers should avoid taking food from an unhygienic place. Just like that, you don't open any app and try to order. You know, of course, we understand that a lot of now food apps are available for your easy, ready to use, and you don't visit the hotel industry, but foods are brought to your home. But again, you need to do a judicial selection of which app to use, which food to item to use, and where, which is the source from which you buy. So should avoid taking food from unhygienic place and food being prepared under unhygienic condition. Such type of food may cause various diseases, and consumption of cut foods being sold in unhygienic conditions should be avoided. Many a times people go to the roadside street vendors, cut fruits which are even not covered. They are being purchased and given to kids or elderly. Their fruit juices on the roadside are just like that carried away and consumed. So it's always better to buy certified food from a reputed shop. So the challenges for food safety, of course, we are in a very modernized or urbanized world. So urbanization and changes in consumer habits, including the travel. We are not confined to our place. We keep traveling, moving in the east and west. We have increased the number of people buying and eating food prepared in public places. We are not only during the present times, I think COVID has brought us back to the scenario where we are confined to eating at home. But still now, after the reopening of the restaurants and food service sector, people have started moving to the restaurants. And globalization has also triggered the growing consumer demand for a wide variety of foods, resulting in an increasingly complex and longer global food chain. So as the world population grows, there is intensification, there is industrialization of agriculture and animal production to meet the increasing demand for food. And this creates both opportunities and challenges for food safety. One side, there is opportunities and growth in the food sector, but there is another side, challenges for food safety. Apart from that, climate change is also predicted to impact the food safety. So the elixir of life is becoming life-threatening due to the presence of these other trends. So to sum up, the key takeaways you could take for today is, as the world grapples with a pandemic of epic proportion, the food we consume and the environment needs to be of higher standard. Every one of us have a role to play. So we don't need to just blame the government body or the regulatory body or the higher authorities or the food safety authorities for the problem. Each one of us have a role to play. Only we all play in unison, this menace can be curbed. Food safety is a shared responsibility between governments, industry, producers, academia, and consumers. And the first line of defense is ensuring that the food is aptly chosen by the consumer. That means you need to first develop a good buying behavior. And greater consumer vigilance and action is necessary. Consumer literacy is the need of the hour, and special attention to low-income groups. They are the most vulnerable groups. They don't have access to the social media and platform. So it is up to us where we can help out through our maids or other people who are working at our homes. We can assist them in increasing their consumer literacy and vigilance and action. Knowledge, awareness about adulterated foods, laws, and rights is crucial for the society. And you should be very much aware that technology heightens opportunities for perpetrators of food fraud, deception, and misrepresentation. One side, technology is helping us to come with new innovations, new food products, new processed foods, new easy to order or easy to eat foods, ready to eat foodstuffs, convenience foods, and all. But the other side, the same technology is also giving opportunities for these food fraud, deception, and misrepresentation. So you should be very much aware of the technology that is being used on both sides. So please use the FSSAI resources that are available on their website. So read what you eat. FSSAI come out with empowering consumers to read the labels and eat safe and nutritious food wherever you are, be it at home, be it at school, or be it at workplace. So have the safe and nutritious concept in your mind to eat safe and food that is not adulterated or that is not substandard. So connect with FSSAI for any concerns when eating out. Look at for the license and registration number of the outlet. So if you don't find, there are a few rules that you can go through in this poster. And if you don't find things safe, you can immediately report to the consumer feedback where the number is given, the mobile app details are given. And you look for food safety display boards in retail stores, milk booths, vegetables and fruit, the retail stores, meat shops, restaurants, street food vendors. So it is high time we educate our street food vendors and bring them to a good standard where they can deliver good food and safe food for us. So thank you all for this wonderful opportunity. I think by this time you should be thinking about yourself, putting across a question to you: are you a fit smart? Are you have so take these key points and be a fit smart as advocated by FSSAI. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am, very much for the wonderful presentation. It was very informative as well as important. There's a common repeated question, ma'am. It's about dry fruits and fake. How do we know if it's like nowadays there are large supply of these dry fruits and figs, right? So how is there any test to find out if there are adulterants in it with dry fruits and
No, since it's the product itself is dry, there is less way of contamination of this because it's all dried, dehydrated, moisture content is removed, so the level of contamination is less. But even then, we cannot dislike that blindly. The only advice that can be given is get it from a reputed source, reputed shop or a sealed or a packaged one, and going for such products only if you find all the relevant materials, as I've said, read the information label from the packs. Nowadays, all the dry food are comes in your packages where all the relevant information is given. So date of packing, date of expiry, if they've got the FSSAI license, if it is organic, there is a symbol called Jaivik Bharat, a green tick that is being given by the FSSAI, if it is an organic product. So all this label information will really help us. So do not get it in loose, do not get it from unidentified sources, get it from reputed shops and reputed and proper packaging.
Okay, there are also, like, since you mentioned organic now, I just wanted to know, there are also brands nowadays, ma'am, that hide behind this label called organic or locally produced and fresh free range, but they are not. So how do we know if it's actually truly authentic or not, the particular product?
Organic products, if you're going to get loose from the shops, there is no way of authentication. But if you're really going to get from reputed organic shops, as I told you earlier, there is a symbol or logo called Jaivik Bharat. You know, J-I-V-I-K, you can even browse through that for the FSSAI website. So Jaivik Bharat is written on that logo with a green color tick, which says that means the product is being authenticated by FSSAI for it to be organic. They have undergone all the tests. So, but if you're going to get organic products in loose, you know, from not from reputed shops, definitely there is no way to check it. You'll have to just believe them telling HS organic, and only after we find any hazard, we will really conclude ourselves whether that was true or not.
Yes, okay, ma'am, I get it. And next, we're moving on to the next question. Since you've said about packaging, you know, being plastic packaging, so can you suggest which plastic is actually safe for, you know, packaging?
I have mentioned tube plastics in my slides. And the thing is, it should be of food grade. You know, if you find the food grade logo on the plastic, that means it is safe to use. So whenever you use such plastic, even for your microwave oven or even for your packing for your lunch or any storing in your household, just turn the cover or at the bottom of the plastic jar or container, whatever it is, the symbol of the food grade will be there. It will be mentioned food grade, you know, and that symbol, triangular symbol should be there, which shows that it's a food grade container, it is safe to use.
Okay, okay, ma'am. Okay. I think that's about it because most are repeated questions. Yes. So thank you very much for answering and also for the wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
For any questions, feedback or queries, you may also write to info@usfn.net. So with this, we reach the end of today's webinar. I thank Dr. P. Savita very much for joining and enlightening us with very deep insight on the major thing that we eat, food. So thank you once again, ma'am, very much.
Thank you. Most welcome, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. Yeah, and thanks to the listeners for the patient hearing.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We will be sharing the feedback as well with you once we receive it. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.